pinako doon sa krus. Ako'y pinatawad ng iyong habag at biyaya. Ikaw ang kayamanan ko, naging dahilan ng buhay ko. Sa Diyos na karapat dapat buhay ko'y iaalay. Papuri sa kataas-taasan, papuri sa aking tagapagligtas. Purihin ka, Jesus, ang Hari ng langit, ang Hari ng sa walang hanggan. Pagkat ikay namatay at nabuhay muli, papuri sa kataas-taasan, papuri sa aking tagapagligtas. Purihin ka, Jesus, ang Hari ng langit, ang Hari ng papuri sa kataas-taasan, papuri sa aking tagapagligtas. Purihin ka, Jesus, ang Hari ng langit, ang Hari ng buhay ko. Papuri sa iyo lamang, ang buhay ko'y sa iyo. Lahat ng papuri sa iyo lamang, ang buhay ko'y sa iyo. Lahat ng papuri sa iyo lamang, ang buhay ko'y sa iyo. Sa aking tagapagligtas, purihin.
Purihin ka, Jesus, ang hari ng langit, ang hari ng buhay ko.
Good evening, Word for the World family, and to all who are joining us tonight for this special Holy Week message. Today would have been the start of your break, your holidays in this Holy Week, although some of you might have taken leave earlier this week to maximize the days and to spend time with your family. And that's good. It's always good to spend time with our family. So wherever you are right now, I hope you are with your families, and wherever you're watching this from, we welcome you. It's Maundy Thursday, and what we usually like to do is to remember the things that happened during the last night that Jesus had with his disciples just before he would be arrested. There's a lot of things that actually happened on that night. Jesus gave many parting words and commands to his disciples, and it would be nice for us to look at those things as we spend time together this evening. The most important thing that happened on Maundy Thursday was the Last Supper, the last meal that Jesus shared. And that being one of the most important things, tonight we will have a time of communion as one family in Christ, one body in Christ. But we would also like for you to have a time of communion with your own family. And I'd like to invite the fathers in the homes to take the initiative and to take the lead in leading your family into communion today. Maybe just prepare the elements, a bread and a drink, grape juice will do. And we will partake of communion in a little while. Before we have our communion, allow me to share a word for us to reflect upon as we have our communion. Holy Week, after all, is a good time to reflect. I hope that you've started your day today in reflection, remembering all that God has done for you. It's a good time to reflect on what God has done for us, but it's also a good time to reflect on what He has called us to do. And that's something we might not think about so much. What did Jesus call us to do? What were His parting words that He left His disciples on the night that He would be betrayed and arrested? I want us to look tonight from the book of John, John chapter 13. And if you have your Bibles, let's open our Bibles and go there. John chapter 13, beginning with verse 1, it says, "It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave the world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end." So we have let's stop there for a while. So we have the details of what happened, or what was the events taking place on that night. It was a Passover feast, a Passover festival. And this is the reason why they came together to share a meal in that place. This was a Jewish feast where they remembered the time when God passed over them and had not struck them. There was a time in their period of history when the Israelites were slaves in Egypt. And one of the, if you remember, the last plague was the plague of the firstborn. And God had commanded them to place the blood on the doorposts of their homes. And when He would come to take away the firstborn, every child, the home that had the blood on the door, when God would see that blood there, He would pass over that house and spare them. And so they were saved by the blood on the doorposts. It was called the Passover because God passed over when he saw the blood. And it was an important historical event for them because it was a time of God's providence, God's protection, and God delivering them. And so they remembered it, much like what we do when we celebrate Holy Week. We do celebrate Holy Week because it's a time that we remember this historical event when Jesus gave his life, God's providence, God's provision that brought us where we are today. It says there in that verse, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the very end. What does this mean? Having loved those that were his own in the world, he loved them to the very end. Now, Jesus spent a lot of time with his disciples. And during the time of ministry that he was with them, he showed them love. He interacted with them. He spent time with them. He laughed with them. He cried with them. He taught them. And that's the idea when having loved those that were his own in the world, having loved his own who were in the world, his disciples, his followers. But then there's a line that says, now he loved them to the very end. What does that mean? You know, some translations can be too literal using word for word, and then we miss the idea of that sentence, having loved them to the very end. In the New Living Translation Bible, if you are using a New Living Translation Bible, you will see a footnote there or a point of reference below. And it says in that footnote what this line really means. It says, he showed them the full extent of his love. So he loved them to the very end. What it really means is at this time, he showed them the full extent, the completion of his love for them. You might ask, did Jesus not love them fully during his time of ministry with them? Of course he did. But there was a side of his love that they had yet to know and experience and probably to see firsthand. And so in this evening, this last evening that he would be with them, he wanted them to see this love as he would give them the parting words. He wanted them to see this firsthand. And so we know it was in this last meal that he shared with them that he instituted communion. The bread they would normally share in different times when they would gather, they would have bread and they would eat together. But this time was different because when he took the bread, he said, "This is my body, which is for you." It was going to be broken for them. When he took the drink, which they normally shared, it was common that they would come together and share a meal. But this time he said, "This is my blood, which will be poured out for the forgiveness of sins." So here he was establishing a new covenant with them, a covenant in his blood. When God made a covenant with his people, there usually was a sacrifice. But this time, he was telling them that the sacrifice was going to be himself. It was a different covenant this time. It would be an everlasting covenant. Because it's not just a blood of an animal. It was not just a temporary sacrifice that would make atonement for their sins. It was going to be his own blood. Jesus was the perfect lamb. So here we see in him showing them the full extent of his love, he is showing them that he is willing to sacrifice himself. He was going to give his life for them. This was him showing them his love. They probably did not understand that time what the bread, how the bread meant his body and how the wine meant his blood. They did not understand at the time how in giving his life, He was actually giving it for them. But they would understand in due time what his death meant for them, just like we understand today what Jesus' death means for us. He was not going to lose this battle. And it might have seemed to many at that time that he was going towards defeat, that his ministry was coming to an end and he was going to lose at this time at the hands of the Gentiles. But really, he was laying down his life to win the battle for us, for you and for me. He was giving his life in order to win the battle for you and me. You see, our victory comes at a price, and it was the death of Jesus Christ. Through Jesus' death, we have victory. Jesus would become the lamb that God provided for us that would cover our sins. He was the substitute sacrifice that would atone for our sins so that we can be set free. So he shows them the full extent of his love when he shows them that he is willing to sacrifice his life. But then he goes on to show them his full love when he also does something else on that night. He suddenly removes his outer robe, and then he goes to each and every one of them and goes down to wash their feet. Now, this probably would have been a very awkward moment for the disciples. Can you imagine if you were there, you were one of the disciples, Jesus removes his outer robe, comes to you with a basin of water and a towel, and he goes down and he starts washing your feet. Here was one that they called Master. Here was one that they called Lord, one whom they had great respect for. They looked up to him. They loved him. They gave up almost everything to follow him. So what he did next made no sense. He was their leader. Why would their leader come down and wash their feet? There was no place for a leader to do. They needed to wash his feet, not the other way around. The washing of the feet was the job of a servant. Not just any servant, a bond servant, which is actually a slave. A slave in the household. In those days, in ancient times, they had slaves. And the slaves had no rights. And they would call on the slaves to do this lowliest jobs of washing the feet of their guests. So it was unthinkable for them to see the man that they revered, to see the man that they so esteemed, so high, doing the lowliest task of washing their feet. And mind you, feet were dirty during that time. They got around walking from place to place, and they didn't have the roads that we have that are paved. It was sandy, and they didn't have Nike shoes and boots. They wore sandals wherever they went. And so their feet were dirty when they got to a certain place. And so Peter reacts. Peter says, "No, Lord, you're not going to wash my feet. I will not participate in this." He felt that it was humiliating for the one that he called Master and Savior and Lord to do such a thing. But what does Jesus say to him? Jesus says to him, "If I don't do this, Peter, then you have no part in me." Now that's a statement worth pondering. Jesus says, "I need to do this for you so that you have a part in me." Why was it so important for Jesus to wash his feet? I believe Jesus wanted him to experience the full extent of his love. He wanted him to know what the love of Jesus meant. And Jesus was trying to show him that my love means humble service. This is how I love. I love by willing to serve. And so this is the second point I want to make to you. The first was that Jesus was willing to sacrifice. The second is he is willing to serve. And then he predicts his betrayal from there. He wanted his disciples to know that in loving, one must be willing to sacrifice. In loving, one must be willing to serve and ready to serve and to do the lowliest things for others. But then what happens next in that passage is that Jesus predicts his betrayal. He says in verse 19 of chapter 13, verse 18, I am not referring to all of you. I know those I have chosen, but this is to fulfill a passage of Scripture. He who shared my bread has turned against me. I am telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am who I am. Very truly, I tell you, whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me. After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in his spirit and testified, very truly, I tell you, one of you is going to betray me. So he predicts and he says, there is one of you here who will betray me. In doing this, he says, he's actually quoting Scripture here. He's showing a fulfillment of Scripture. Psalm 41 verse 9 is the fulfillment of this Scripture, where he who shared a bread with him has turned against him. The disciples started to think, who could it be? They start to, you know, elbow each other, and they're pointing at John because John was seated next to Jesus. Why don't you ask him? Who is it? They wanted to know, who is the one who's going to betray our master? What does Jesus say? In verse 22, it says, his disciples stared at one another, at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him, and that's John. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, ask him which one he means. Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, it is the one whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish. Now they were all sharing bread. So it could have been anyone. But at this point, Jesus is going to reveal to them who that person is. Now we usually see this passage as Jesus revealing it to them who it really was. But really something deeper is taking place here. You know, I did some research and reading into the customs of during that time, and what the meaning of sharing a bread meant, or dipping the bread in the same dish with a person. Sharing food with someone carried an implication of friendship and peace. It was an act of love and acceptance. So when Jesus was revealing to his disciples that he would be betrayed, he was also revealing his love and acceptance of the man who would betray him by dipping the bread in the dish and sharing it with this man. See, it's the ultimate love that one can show. To show love and acceptance to the one who would do harm to you and hurt you. Jesus taught them during the time of his ministry to love your enemies. Here, he was showing them how he was following that, how he was loving one who was his enemy, one who had plotted to do him harm. one who was going to betray him. And here he was showing them the full extent of his love, that he was ready to love even the one who would betray him. And this is the third way that Jesus showed them his love. First, he was willing to sacrifice. Second, he was willing to serve. And the third, he was willing to separate the person from the sin. He was willing to love the person despite their sin, despite their sin against him. Later in that chapter, in verses 34 and 35, Jesus says, "A new command I give you, love one another." Now, this was not new. He kept teaching them about loving one another. But here, he had showed them the full extent of his love. A love that was willing to sacrifice, a love that was willing to serve, a love that was willing to separate the person from the sin, basically to love your enemy. And so he tells them, "This is the new command I'm giving you. As I have loved you, so you must love one another." As I have loved you, as you have seen and experienced my love for you, this is the same way you must love one another. And then he says, "By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." So here we see why he shows them his love, because he was going to leave them a command. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. Not just any kind of love. This is a specific love that God calls us to do. The way he has loved, we are to love one another. In his love, he was willing to sacrifice his life. In his love, he was willing to serve others in humility. In his love, he was willing to separate people from their sin and love even the ones who would hurt him. And then he adds, by this very thing, if you do this, everyone, the world will know that you're my disciples if you do this. You want to be recognized as my follower? This is how you will be recognized as my follower, as my disciple. So Jesus is saying indirectly, if we do not do this, if we do not love the way he has loved, then we are not representing him. We are not representing who he is. And therefore, we cannot really call ourselves his disciple. When you do this, when you love the way Jesus loved, you show to the world that you are truly his disciple. Now, Jesus wants everyone in the world to know his love. It says, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son." He wants everyone to know his love. And later, he would command his disciples to go into the world to preach the good news of the gospel, baptizing people, making disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. He would command them to go and take the gospel, the good news of the gospel, into the world. But how does Jesus communicate his love to a world that does not know his love? Have you ever thought of that? How does Jesus communicate? How does Jesus make his love known to the world that does not know his love? You want to know how? He makes the world know his love by the way you and I love one another. As we represent him, as we truly become his disciples and followers, the world comes to know the love of Jesus Christ. Our love for one another is one of the ways that God reveals his love to the world. So this Holy Week, it's just the start of the Holy Week We have Good Friday, Saturday, we have our Easter Sunday celebrations. We have a lot of time to reflect. Let this be something that we ask from our Lord. Let us ask Jesus to make our love more like His love. And I'm sure we do love one another. We do exercise love on a daily basis towards our loved ones, people around us. But is it the same kind of love as Jesus? A love that is willing to sacrifice, a love that is willing to serve, a love that is willing to separate the person from their sin. Let us ask God to make us more like Him in the way we love, so that more people would come to know His love. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us how you have loved us. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us that in this time, just as we reflect on what you have done for us, help us to reflect on what you have called us to do. And you have called us to love the way you have loved. You have revealed to us that this is how the world will know that we belong to you, that we follow you. This is how we represent you. And Lord, we want to represent you well. We want the world to know you, Lord. Let our love reveal it today. Let the way we love bring someone to know you. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me invite now the fathers to take the bread. We will partake of communion at this time. Maybe you can take the bread in your hands and distribute it to everyone in your family, in your home. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, He took the bread. And after He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this whenever you eat it in remembrance of me." Let us now partake of the bread. Would you take the drink now? In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This is now the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us partake of the drink. Hallelujah. Lord, we are grateful. We are grateful for what you have done for us. We are grateful, Lord, that you have given us a way to remember what you have done for us. Thank you, Lord, for what the bread represents, your body broken for us. You suffered and died, Lord, not for any of your sin, but for our sins. You became sin for us. Thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice. Thank you, Lord, for what your blood means to us. Thank you, Lord, that is the most precious thing in our life, cleansing us, washing us, making us pure and holy, forgiving us our sins. We are forever grateful, Lord. Lord, just as you have loved us unconditionally, you have loved us with a very deep kind of love. We pray, O Lord God, that you help us to love one another the way you have loved us. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you for joining us tonight for our Monday-Thursday service. Tomorrow, we will have our Good Friday service in the church, in the worship center. Please do join us. And on Sunday, we have our special Easter cantata, The Hope of the Cross. We also have our sunrise service at 5:30. You can join us for our sunrise service. If you live in the area, it will be a wonderful time of worshiping God as the dawn rises. Thank you so much for being with us. God bless you. Have a wonderful and meaningful weekend.
Took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin.